Il dit quand c'est bon pour toi. Bon. Good morning everybody. That's fine. Everybody seems to hear me fine. Okay. So let's start. This speak is a continuation speak of a speak last year about Ethereum and identity. EDIT stands for Ethereum Decentralized Digital Identity Trust Services. And what we wanted to achieve by developing this project is to first materialize the concept of identity on the blockchain, which is quite common now today. But more than that, to link real and sovereign identity to this identity on the blockchain. And that's what I will focus on today. Because you have moved a little bit from pure identity to link between real identity and blockchain identities, and I will explain why and how during this talk. Who am I? I'm Fabrice Croiseau, CEO of Intech. Intech is a company located in Luxembourg of little more than 100 people developing standard application, but also lots of blockchain-based projects, and mainly on Ethereum, and when it's possible, on the Ethereum public blockchain. What is our mission regarding this public blockchain and Ethereum? We really want to bridge the gap between the standard financial ecosystem and the public blockchain. We want everything, every time it's possible, we want to develop real financial solutions and projects on top of the public blockchain. And it's not so easy because when we want to do that, we have to deal with regulators, we have to deal with real banks, and they are often afraid of coming on the public blockchain. Why? For three main reasons. First, the concept of identity and more than identity, KYC. KYC is a common word in the financial world, meaning know your customer, and knowing your customer is mandatory because otherwise you can't provide any financial services, and you are obliged to know precisely who is the owner of an account and who owns money, securities, or anything, any digital asset on any system and on the blockchain. And as you know, on the public blockchain mainly, it's not mandatory to provide your identity to be able to have an Ethereum account and to start exchanging tokens or Ether. So we need identity and we need known identities. Two other topics I won't talk about now, because there is another speech tomorrow by Antoine here that will explain you how we can achieve privacy and accountability on the public blockchain. Privacy on the private blockchain is easy today, but on public blockchain is harder. And we have, using some parity tools, we have achieved privacy, and as a real interesting side effect of privacy, we have achieved accountability. And privacy is not mandatory, because if users, customers, and banks allow to have a transparent account, it's possible today. It's not mandatory by the regulators, but accountability is mandatory. And it's difficult also, given the decentralized nature of blockchain, to have accountability. And here we have a solution to provide accountability. I stop talking about that now, but come tomorrow, the same room, at 5 p.m., to see how it's possible on the public blockchain. And with identity, privacy, and accountability, you can provide real financial services on blockchain approved by regulators. Let's come back to identity. What you have done last year and until now, what you have done, you have connected sovereign identity, not self-sovereign identity, but sovereign identity. That means identity provided by governments or certification authorities to a blockchain identity. And this in a trustless way, each time it's possible. It's not always possible, depending on the details, on how the identity is built. But every time it's possible in a trustless way, what does that mean? It means without needing another trusted third party in the process of enrollment of my identity to the blockchain. This is what you have done until now. To do that, we used last year ERC 725 and ERC 735 I won't go into deep details about that, but it's an identity standard that has been proposed by Fabian Vogelsteller, the creator of ERC20, that everybody knows, I think, in the room, to model how identity should be implemented in a smart contract. This is ERC725. And how claim holder have to be also implemented through smart contracts. And claims are very important regarding identity because conceptually, at least, an identity is nothing more than a set of claims about a person, about a subject. And claims have to be validated by trusted entities to be usable in a real business. So we have started by allowing our users to create their identity on the blockchain and to link their real identity modeled either by identity card or by certificate to this identity. And how did we do that? By linking a digital certificate, so X509 certificate. X509 is the most common way of modeling digital identity on internet. It's a standard, and we are able to link this digital certificate that are delivered by a trusted certification authority to the blockchain identity. And to do that, we started, since we are located in Luxembourg. Luxembourg is not a big country, as you know, and we have the chance in Luxembourg to have only one certificate provider, which is named LuxTrust, who provide all identities to every people in Luxembourg, not only Luxembourg citizen, but also foreign people who are working in Luxembourg, like me. And with this only certificate, you can connect to multiple banks accounts, but also to the public authorities to deposit your tax form, to ask for some public services with only one identity. It's really cool. It's close to what is possible today with France Connect in France. I will come back to that after. But it's a real certificate, and it's a qualified identity. What does qualified identity mean? Is that every signature made by this identity has to be accepted by a court in case of dispute. And today, this concept are handled by the eIDAS regulation, which is a European regulation that explained how an identity, what are the constraints an identity has to meet to be able to be accepted by in front of a court as a real signature. To do that, we have developed a claim issuer that will verify the RSA signature created by the certificate. And since last year, so it was in 2017, October, the new fork of Ethereum the new version, it was more than 1 year ago, it was possible in the EVM to validate an RSA signature. For, I don't know, who, maybe everybody knows RSA here? No? Okay. Just in few words, what is RSA? RSA is another algorithm used to use public and private key to sign documents or to authenticate. We have two main ways to do that today, RSA or elliptic curves. And elliptic curves are the one used on all blockchain technologies and especially on Ethereum. So you know on Ethereum you have a private key, you have a public key materialized by the Ethereum address. And you sign with your private key, and when you sign with your private key, you use elliptic curves. But with digital certificate, X509, it's not elliptic curve, it's RSA. And before this version of Ethereum, it was very difficult to verify an RSA signature. You can easily verify an elliptic curve-based signature, but RSA, it was very difficult, and it was very costly in terms of gas. And now it's built in the EVM. It's very easy, so that's why we have built that. And today it's possible to verify that my certificate belongs to me, and more than that, has been created by the certification authority I pretend. So I can verify it's a real certificate, and that the name on this certificate, in my case Fabrice Croiseau, is linked to the blockchain identity and to a specific or a set of Ethereum address. So that's the KYC, what I named KYC before, Know Your Customer, is achieved through this means. So this is what we did last year. What are we doing now? First, we want to be more independent from any specific identity model, because we used the ERC-725 because it was cool, it was free, easy to implement, but we see that there are other identity models that need the same capabilities that the one we have developed. For example, UPort. UPort is another way to create identity, to manage access to blockchain. But we also want to support any wallet that will arise on the market and that will ease access to blockchain. And these wallets will have lots of very, very interesting capabilities, and they need sometimes or often to be connected to real identities. And for example, here's the example I give is Argent. The presentation just after mine will be given by people from Argent Lab showing their wallet. And our goal is also to be able to use this kind of wallet provider to connect a real identity to their wallet and then to their identity on the blockchain. So first objective, be independent from a specific identity model. We will keep ERC-725 and 735 as a reference implementation. We'll continue to deploy the first version to be compatible with ERC-725, but we will have SDK-like or framework to allow our development to be connected to any identity model. Secondly, to achieve that, we have genericity. Two kinds of genericity. First, between identities and proof of identities, because as you have understood, what we do really is to make the proof of identity. The proof, we create a blockchain-based proof of real identity. And this proof of real identity will be reused by the blockchain identity providers. So we had genericity on that top. But another thing is we had genericity between identity providers, for example, ERC-725 or Argent, and people who need to access identity data. Because for lots of reasons, and especially GDPR, I think lots of you know what GDPR is. GDPR verifies that private data are handled correctly. To be able to be GDPR compatible, it's not possible to store real data and public data on the blockchain. I can't store my name, my first name, my birth date, my country of residence, etc. on the public blockchain. I can do that if I want, but if a service provider does that for me, he won't be allowed to do that due to GDPR. So when we want to access this identity data, we are also providing a way for an application provider to ask the identity provider for my data. And I have to allow that. And all this workflow is handled by the blockchain. So let's imagine I want to buy something on Amazon with Ether in a few years. And Amazon has to verify that I am more than 18. And my birth date is not located on the blockchain. And imagine I use Argent, for example, as a wallet provider. So what I will do, Amazon will ask me, okay, connect to Amazon with my wallet. I will connect with Argent on Amazon, and Amazon will ask Argent to if I'm more than 18 or not. And I have to allow Amazon to access my data. And I will say yes, and then Argent will provide identity, and we can create business model behind that, which is very cool. And then I will be able to buy my book or anything, because they have verified everything. It's this simple case is on Amazon, but when we talk about financial services, you have lots of things to verify that I'm not blacklisted by the European Commission or by the US, that I'm not politically involved, etc., etc. More private data, and using the same mechanism, it would be possible to verify that I am allowed to buy this kind of securities using my wallet. Add more identity providers. So what you have already done, the first one, we start with the easiest one in terms of not technically, but publicly availability and accessibility. We start with Estonian e-citizens cards. I don't know if everybody of you knows, but it's possible in Estonian from through the web to apply for an e-citizenship. And when you have to pay, I don't remember how many, but around 100 euro, I think, you have to pay. And then you go to the local Estonian ambassade, and they give you a card. It's like an ID card. But with this card, you are a e-citizen of Estonian, and you can, for example, open a business in Estonian without going in Estonia. You can open a bank account, create a company, and Estonia is in Europe. So this company is passported, and you can provide business, develop your activity as an Estonian company without having to go in Estonia. So this identity card contains a chip. It's a little card. And this chip is a X509 certificate, the same I was talking about before. So we have developed an interface between Estonian ID cards and e-citizenship card and our solution to be able to allow any Estonian e-citizen to connect his Estonian identity to his blockchain identity or address and then to provide his services through the blockchain. France Connect also. So France Connect is specific to France. Is not an identity by itself, but it's an interface between existing identities, from the one from Post, the one from the government, so the one used by the tax government ministry to connect you to their website, and also the one provided by your mobile operator. You can use all these identities through the same interface to connect to any website that supports France Connect. And what we did, it's possible to use this API. Today it's possible for any French citizen to connect through France Connect to a blockchain-based and Ethereum public blockchain-based identity using France Connect. So it's not possible in production because they have not opened their services for non-public institutions today. They will do that for private institutions in the upcoming months, but today it's not possible. So it's possible in test or in a production environment, but in test, as soon as they will open their system to non-public companies, it will be possible to use your French identity to connect to blockchain. ADAS. So ADAS is, I talked about ADAS just before. So this is this regulation from the Europe that will, so each country can, today is not forced to, but can have an ADAS notified identity. And when you have an ADAS notified identity, every country in Europe are forced to support it for all their public services. So if today in France you don't have any ADAS notified identity, but as soon you will have one, you will be able to use it to connect to any to the public services of any country in Europe. And they have developed a concept. Each country has to implement what they call an ADAS node, and we connect to this ADAS node to link your ADAS identity to a blockchain identity. And we are continue to develop. This is the core function of our system, to continue to develop connection between real identities and blockchain identities. Another interesting feature is a qualified identity and signature compliance. When you have this identity, after you can sign with a certificate, you can sign a document, digitally sign the PDF, for example, and use it as a real signature. Today, you know that the concept of signature is central in the blockchain world. And what you want to achieve is to make a blockchain-based signature accepted as an advanced signature, but also as a qualified signature. To do that, you have to fulfill some constraints, and some are not related to blockchain, but for example, you are forced to have a third party, a third factor identification. So a token, a mobile, or something. And what is interesting is that today, all the implementation of third-party third factor, they don't provide the proof that a signature has been made using this third-party device. You know, they audited that their workflow use and forced to use third factor, but they have not the proof that it has been used. And it's at least technically possible to create this kind of signature without, even without using this third factor of authentication. What you do using FIDO, FIDO stands for Fast Identity Online. It's a standard created by lots of actors and especially Google. They provide token that are used to, as a third factor and supported by Chrome, by all Chrome browsers, for example. And using FIDO device to sign, it's possible to prove with the signature on the blockchain that this third factor has been used. So it won't be possible for anybody to say, oh, this signature, it hasn't been done by complying with all the standards, because we will have on the blockchain all the proof, and it's quite innovative because today it doesn't exist at all with a standard signature mechanism, and the way the proof is by being audited by somebody. It costs a lot, and it's not as secure as it will be with this solution. Sample use case, I won't enter into detail. If you want to have more detail about T-Rex, T-Rex stands for Token for Regulated Exchange, but we have used all these features to allow one of our partners and customer, which is Tokeny, to deploy, to issue real securities. And since it's real securities, they have to perform the KYC. So we have developed this smart contract-based standard or model that we call T-Rex that combine our identity model, all what I've been talking about now, to securities model and smart contracts. They combine all together to achieve the compliance, the financial compliance of standard securities. So this is an interesting use case where, again, here it's we talk about compliance by design. Why? Because today, so it's mandatory to know the identity of each stakeholders in a security transaction. But it's mandatory, but it's possible that I sell a security to somebody I don't know, and to somebody that has not been controlled by any bank. It's physically possible, even if it's not allowed by the regulators, it's possible, and especially in Il Caiman, in some countries, it can happen at least. Maybe it doesn't, but it can. With the blockchain-based compliance, it's not possible. Why? Because when I want to send my token, which model of securities, to an address on the blockchain, the first thing the smart contract will do is to verify that my identity has been controlled, that a real identity has been linked to my blockchain identity, and that this identity is valid and comply with all the constraints of my securities. For example, I have to be a European citizen, and if I'm not a European citizen, the transfer won't simply happen because the smart contracts won't allow that. And that's why we call compliant by design. And when we explain that to regulators, we prove that the level of compliance is higher on the blockchain than it is today in the current financial ecosystem. And it's often a surprise for them because they think that it's easier to use blockchain to fake identities or to not to apply all the compliance rules. But when development has made in a certain way, it's the compliance is enforced, and it's more difficult to bypass it. This was my last slide. Thanks a lot for your attention. If you have some question, I think you have 2 or 3 minutes to answer.
Thanks a lot.